Well, I was single 4 years back. So, and then I got promoted. Okay. So this talk is about DevOps, what DevOps is actually not, and how this is actually relate. So 4 years back, I met this wonderful girl, and then I got married. And then the things started to get more complicated, a lot complicated. Trying to understand one another, what are the likes, what are the dislikes, what we should do. Rather than, I thought, let's take a break. Instead of making things more complicated, why can't we make it simple? So instead of starting to think about what she likes, or she started thinking about what I like, we started to do it in a really pessimistic manner. What we don't like. Start with the negatives first. So I don't like this, I don't like that. And these things are pretty simple to understand, to figure out. And if you want to count it on your fingers, you could literally count them. Like, I don't like to stay late in the night, like those kind of things, okay? Or I don't like to eat bitter gourd, okay? So I started with a talk last year, and it was about DevOps again. I looked at the crowd, and the crowd was like really amazing. They were thinking, what the heck you are talking about? We already know these things, right? So I came up with another idea. Let's try it reverse this time. What DevOps is actually not. Some of the similarities between the marriage and DevOps. What I thought about is both of them are very big and vast chapters, okay? DevOps is not about tools. Everybody knows that. Everybody must have read multiple articles on various different websites. It's fine, right? So a couple of days later or years later, I got promoted again. I became a father. So what my wife taught me before, the pessimistic way of understanding things, let's understand what we should not be doing rather than trying to please one another. Then when I became a father, what could be the first word my wife taught my baby or my little girl? It was no. It wasn't dada, it wasn't mama, it wasn't mom, nothing. No. And she says no so pleasingly well that you could get convinced. But literally, this is no, you shouldn't be doing that. Okay? And that's where all these concepts came in. And now, a couple of years later, when I started to work at EE, I got promoted as a DevOps architect, and now I help people to understand what you shouldn't be doing, because everyone knows what they should be doing. DevOps is closely related with business principles, the way you should be doing your business, and no one teaches you that. You know what you should be doing. You know where you are lacking. You know what has to be done. What are your long-term goals? What are your short-term goals? Right? Everyone knows that. And if someone tells you that, dude, you're not doing your business right, how does it feel like? Okay? So instead of telling you how DevOps should be done, at least tell you the pitfalls that you shouldn't be doing these things. Okay? So that's my third introduction. Okay? So my name is Ashish Nanotkar, and I work at EE as a DevOps consultant. I've been working for last 1 year helping people out with technologies, technology stacks, pipelines, dealing with their business problems, helping them deliver things faster, better, more efficiently. And when I was searching for the jobs before I came to EE, does it look familiar? The job description? Anyone? Does it look like a testing job description? Can you raise your hands, please? Or just shout out loud what kind of job profile this is. It's a system administration. Someone else? People who would be doing hiring, I would like to know. DevOps engineer. Yes, someone else. Totally devs profile, totally ops profile. Okay, this is where people are really mistaken. I was too. A couple of years back. I started as a freelancer, so a lot of things, I've made a lot of people, I've been working on a lot of problems, luckily working with a lot of stacks, I know problems well, I know how to interact with people. Then I started to look for a job which suits that profile, and this is what I commonly look for. So what I understood from this, devs who are actually looking for shiny jobs, and the most forbidden word to say, money, right? They think that if I choose DevOps over any other job profile, it would pay me well. Okay, fairly good. It does that, but this is not a DevOps profile. Okay, and a lot of jobs that I see in the market these days, we want a person who knows Chef, we want a person who knows Ansible, we want a person who knows Jenkins, a lot of blah, blah, blah kind of things. This comes up. And this is, sorry to say, a purely ops profile. Just ops profile. It has nothing to do with DevOps. That might shatter your dreams for the recruiting guys, but that's the truth. Okay? So for any company who doesn't has something like, we want a person who understands Agile well, we want a person who understands problem statements well, we want a person who knows how to deal with problems and automate them, or remove the redundancy, if it is not in the job profile, please don't touch it, it's not DevOps anymore. Why? There's a reason for that. Has anybody tried typing commands like CD on their console before? Dumb question, right? LS, probably user add, group add, rsys, rsync, FTP, telnet. What are these things? Commands? These are utilities. And what gets behind these utilities is actually a code. Some smart person, a developer rather, coded something for you, and you are using it. These days, in the last 3 or 4 years maybe, your tools got just a lot friendlier. They got friendlier from your black and white screens. They got projected onto nice browser screens, colorful, histograms, nice analytics diagrams. Okay, that's what it did. So just using the tools, not on the black and white screens anymore, but you're using it on your browsers, does it mean that in any way you have changed your life, you have changed your responsibilities or your goals? You haven't. So this is not DevOps. Okay, a lot of slides here would be talking about what DevOps is not. But at the end, we will talk about what it actually means, right? So that's not DevOps for me. People generally say, if you want to do DevOps or I'm hiring a DevOps engineer, let's do something like installing Jenkins. Or we already have TeamCity, so we hire an engineer. Do you know you using TeamCity? Say yes. Okay, you are a DevOps engineer now. Sit in the team and do your job. Okay, how easy is that? Like install Jenkins, use Puppet or Chef, probably move to cloud. We don't want any private systems for ourselves. We would be moving everything to upfront payments, reduce the upfront cost and do all these things. Everyone knows a lot of tools here. If I started to count and we list it out, it would be more than 100 taken together, all of you. Okay? That's not even DevOps. So people say, if you will deploy using Docker, let's do it. It's the fancy thing today, right? Containerization. Some people would like to debate over whether or not to use Docker Swarm or Kubernetes or Mesos, or just use Docker directly, or use the new feature which is launched in Docker 1.12. Again, that's not even DevOps, okay? Some of the companies, or bigger companies that I worked with, actually worked with a lot of companies, fortunately, and everyone was different. Everyone did their job their own ways. So there's a concept called CAB, C-A-B. Can someone tell me what C-A-B actually stands for? Sorry? Control access board, okay. Someone else? It's very similar. Those are the gatekeeper guys. So what they say, before even you move to production, tell us what you're going to send out. So we are the gatekeepers. We wouldn't be letting you throw things out. We would be testing everything. We would be making sure that the checklist is all proper. Does it prevent you from getting bugs out of production? It doesn't, right? So why is CAB even there? Long behind, like 4 or 5 years back when I was working, we had a CAB system back then, and we used to release every Thursday. And there was a CAB meeting held on Wednesdays, okay? So if I missed something on maybe a login screen and I wanted to add it, I would have to wait for another week. Why? Just to get an approval, and that approval was to change the spelling from small k to big k. That's it. Is it even feasible? In the days when we are leaving, we know that there's a new year is coming, and probably at Amazon they would be releasing a new feature out because they want larger clientele. Okay, So for releasing a new feature on the New Year's Eve, can you still stick with the CAB meetings and then approve it maybe once a week or once a month kind of cycle? It doesn't work, right? So the idea about CAB was very generic back then when there were stages, waterfall model. But now when we are doing agile, it isn't, because we have streamlined the pipes. Every single line of code moves through a small pipe which is in parallel, okay? And when you move things in parallel, they become more complex. If you move it in parallel and you say, okay, I'm building a house of cards and I'm adding one card at a time, one line of code at a time, okay? And I want to test everything. That means when I put a card there, it should mean that the card is placed at the proper location. That means your feature is built right, plus the regression or the complete house stays stable. That was the whole idea of CAB. But these days when you're moving so, so fast, it's of no use. It would only slow things down. So people say, just remove CAB and we would be doing DevOps. Does it help? Some extent, it doesn't help, rather. And the job definition, definitely it was for automated ops. That's not even DevOps. And sorry to say if I'm shattering a lot of dreams here, just by saying that this is not DevOps, this is not DevOps, or this is not, again, not DevOps, right? We start transforming. There are companies who would like to move with a new era, and they say, okay, we would like to move, we would like to change ourselves because the world is moving towards greater technology, we would be embracing agile, and if someone is knowing agile well or keeping track of the timeline, they must know that agile was dead in early 2015, I think, and people have started moving towards modern agile now. So are we even doing the right thing at the right point, at the right time? No, we are just trying to catch up. We're trying to catch up, catch up behind the bigger giants who are working in the market, okay? Has anybody heard about a DevOps job at Google? Can you raise your hand if you had? Or a DevOps job even at Facebook? A job titled DevOps? No. Why? What I think is, DevOps is rather a journey. It's not your destination. There is no destination called DevOps. It's not that you all sit together in a family photograph and call that photograph as a DevOps. No, it's not. Okay? So what we are trying to do here is trying to prevent the pitfalls that you would be doing while transforming your company from a non-DevOps company to a DevOps company that you would be calling it. Okay? But the end product of it, that I'm saying DevOps company, it's not actually a DevOps thing. The transformation is called DevOps. And the way we transform it, there are a couple of pitfalls that you should not be doing. And there are a lot of articles out there on the internet that would tell you what has to be done, what not has to be done. So I'm not inventing anything. I rather believe that we are not inventing problems. We are not. If someone thinks that I'm in a genuinely unique problem, sorry to say, again, look for yourself, look for the problem, okay? And the thing is, we are just rediscovering things. Things that people discovered 15 years back or 20 years back, we are just trying to rediscover them, trying to figure out the solutions all by ourselves. The good part here would be to learn from their mistakes and read from whatever documentation is available for them. Okay, so I'm not inventing anything. It's been taken from a website called devopsguys.com, and these are anti-patterns, total of 12, things that you should not be doing when you're transforming your company from non-DevOps to DevOps. And it takes a lion's heart to actually start transforming. The biggest question in my last talk when I delivered about DevOps, people started to ask, okay, everything is fine. And talk is good, but what we get is, you are asking us to transform. Is it an easy thing? No, it's not. It's not when you still have baggages with you. Okay? Baggages as in your old routines, your team sizes, or your team structure, your vertical hierarchies, okay? Your culture that you have set. So the startups that are starting these days, they already have these things in mind. And they start with a very new spark. They know what they should be looking like in the next 5 or 10 years, and they start the culture right now, like that. And they slowly try to adapt to it. Learn and adapt. Bigger companies, they were started just like that. They had their own culture back then when the technology was not this smart. Now the technology is changing, they're not changing with it. Okay? So here are pitfalls. See, very first thing is, any devs here? A lot of, right? Do you test before you commit? Yes. Who doesn't test before he commits? No? No one? No, actually, there is a reward for them. All right. So take it as a culture and not as a process. If you leave your company right now and you start moving into another company, you work for them, would you stop testing your code back then in your new company? Would you stop testing it? No. If you again move into another company, would you stop testing the code there? No. So it's not a process. It's a culture that sticks with you. You're doing the things because you feel that it is right to do it. Okay? There is no cheat sheet given to you when you join a company. There is not. They don't tell you, they don't preach you that you should be testing the code and then tick mark it. Okay, the cap sheet now. Tick mark, test the code. Okay, I've tested it, I've committed it, I've pushed it, I've reviewed it. It sticks as a culture. So if you take code movement, which is horizontal, not vertical, that's again another thing that you should be understanding. People think that the code moves vertical. Or rather, they don't think it, think at all. Okay? Teams are structured vertically. Associate engineers, senior engineers, team leads, CTOs. And if you want to jump across the teams, you need to cross all these hierarchies. Trust me, you need to. Let's say you are a dev and you want to talk to an ops guy who's sitting maybe in other corner of your office. You can't directly go there and ask him. Why? I'm talking about a bigger company. The reason why is everyone is too skeptical about taking responsibilities. The whole culture about DevOps is what we say is you built it, you run it. That's the whole notion, okay? And when we lack this thing, that I built it, I'm not going to run it, someone else is going to run it, it's his problem. If it is not running, don't call me at 2 a.m. in the morning and say that this is not working, it's not my fault. The blame games, you shouldn't be doing that. That's the biggest problem while transforming. You need to get rid of it. Okay, so when you want to talk between these two teams, ops and dev, it has to go through a channel. Okay, when you go through a channel, it starts with an email. Please approve this, we want to deploy this. I want this much infrastructure. And how much time does it take? At least one level, one day for one-way communication. Gets approved, again travels back to you. 5 steps up, 5 steps down, 10 days, 10 plus 10, 20 days, your month is gone. And that happens, that literally happens. How many people have literally seen this happen in their companies? Probably you are from a bigger company. Good for you, right? So all these things happen. So we don't see DevOps as a process, okay? We want to stick to it as a culture. And when I say culture, it doesn't come straight away, in a night. You don't say that we are building a CI/CD pipeline, we are building it in a cave. And trust me, building a CI/CD pipeline isn't that hard. You could do it in a matter of 15, 30 minutes. Or if you have automated that, even less. And then you say, hey devs, hey testers, hey ops guys, this is what we have built, start using it. Now, this never happens. You shouldn't be doing that. And people who started to do that have quickly identified that the CI/CD pipeline is kept somewhere else, rusting, dusting. No one uses it. You force people to commit the code at the right time, you force people to test their code, you force people to do code reviews, nothing happens. Nothing happens. So once I was with this company where these people were working with Mercurial. Anybody worked with Mercurial yet? Yeah, good. The problem is with pushing the code. Once you push a code, no one else can push it unless and until they pull the code again. And after they pull the code, they again like merge it, test it, and again push it. The problem there was, these people were using Mercurial, not as Mercurial, but as SVN. Now you see what the problem is. So how does DevOps come to rescue? Let's say you want to change the culture. So what do you do first? Do you ask people to stop using Mercurial and start using Subversion? Or say, don't use Mercurial like Subversion? Or train them? We came up with a smart idea, or rather a very simple idea. The idea was, instead of using edg as their command, we created a wrapper. And that wrapper was maybe SEdg or SmartEdg. So instead of using edg, you use something else, then wrapper would take care of doing everything for you. Everything as in lining up your commits, testing whether the commits are well, whether they are properly working with other commits, and doing your push on your behalf. Someone else would be doing it. So you don't need to worry about pulling your code, testing it, and doing all these things again and again. That was smart back then. But the good part would be if you would move from edgy to Git or maybe Subversion, depending on what kind of team structure you're looking forward to, right? Another problem here is people think, I'm doing Agile, so if I'm making things work, I might also be doing DevOps. Or, take it other way around, that would also be true. Like if I'm doing DevOps using all the tools that are mentioned in the market, we are a nice Agile company. Has anybody witnessed this before? Maybe many of you. Afraid to raise your hands, actually. Okay. That happens. That's not. Okay? The first thing about DevOps is, it started as a problem-solving thing for Agile. Agile solved a lot of problems for us. A lot of problems. It made things faster, it made things repeatable, it made things deployable, faster to market, better team management, and all those things. Innovation, right? Great. But the problems that it started, who is going to do regular testing? The house of card testing now. You need to test that particular card, plus you need to make sure that the complete house is stable. So if you're building a code, you're building a product, you need to test that particular feature, plus you need to make sure that the features which are touched by that particular feature are also safe, plus the product is not broken, and you need to do that 1,000 times a day if you have a team of 20 developers committing 50 times a day. Or maybe 50 committers committing 20 times a day, whatever the calculation is. Right? That creates problem. That needs smarter solutions. That needs automation in place. Okay? That's where the DevOps came in. So it came in as a complementary package with your Agile. So if you're doing Agile, and you want to do it smarter way, you want to do it in faster order, you need to have some automation in place, plus the Agile culture. So culture comes from there. Tooling comes from ops guys. And people who would like to make both things together or touch on both the things are called DevOps engineers, just for a span of the DevOps journey, not for next 50 years, okay? So people do this. They try to convert existing teams into DevOps. I witnessed that as well. 3 years back when I was working, we had a DevOps team. And what was bad with the DevOps team, actually, it was a fascinating team. Work culture, awesome. You need to satisfy the requirements for all the people, be like, a star guy in the organization, nice, cool. But the DevOps team quickly started to show up as a support team. I committed my code, and we were using Subversion back then. I'm committing my code, and the person says, where's my code? I don't know. I just committed it. Whether it's on the testing environment, whether it's on the UAT, whether it's on the staging, or it's in the production, how do I know? Or another famous question, I committed it right now, or maybe 5 minutes back, it's not appearing there. I can't see my feature. Or I committed my code days back, 2 days back, it's not in production. Okay, stupid questions. Or how do I commit? Or maybe how do I merge a branch? Well, DevOps team is not meant for doing all of these things, right? Their work is to set up things for you so that you could self-service yourselves. So the teams who do not realize the importance of self-serving systems, self-servicing systems actually, fail to do better DevOps at the end of the day. I take a small problem here. There was a DBA who was spending, let's say, 5 minutes a day. 5 minutes one time for checking the status of his 12 databases across various different data centers. 12 different locations, took 5 minutes, one time. Okay? And he did that maybe 10 times a day. So if you do a simple math, so 5 into 12, right, 12 times, it's 60 minutes. 10 times a day, it means 16 to 10, right? 10 hours. 10 hours, right? 1 hour. Am I doing the wrong math? No? 1 hour a day, sorry. It's 5 minutes, 12 times a day, it's 1 hour. So he's wasting 1 hour out of the total working time just monitoring the databases. Is his work monitoring the databases, or his work is actually making sure that all the databases are healthy? Some might say that it's same, but it's not. If you could see the redundancy in this pattern, look for the redundancy in your organization and try to fix it, okay? So people try to, let's say, look for or ask for IP addresses of the servers to the DevOps guys. Do you see a pattern? If some of the requests try to come in, maybe 50 requests a day from 50 different people trying to get the IP address for testing purposes, it would be a lot of headache for the DevOps guys, who you would be paying a lot more premium than your devs or your testers. Okay? So if you want to see a pattern here, if you could reduce that 1 hour that he's spending, the DBA is spending, on that particular timesheet, reduce it to 1 minute a day, or maybe 1 multiplied by 12 minutes a day, you could save 48 minutes of his life. And if you have 10 DBAs in your office, even more. Okay? So people who have zeal for looking for these kind of patterns, the redundant patterns, and they can also automate things, can be better DevOps guys, can help you in the transition. Okay? Some people think that DevOps, development would lead ops, so don't figure out how to set up your architecture first, try to set up the software, build it, and on the end day, on the fortnight, we will think about putting it into production. We'll think about how big the infrastructure should be or what kind of the architecture it should be. Generally think about it, okay? That's not even DevOps. Another one, people generally start with this, that DevOps is a buzzword. It's not. People have been doing it, and it's been shown in one of the talks before. Okay, so Dan told you that DevOps has been around for last, God knows how many years, ages, centuries. It's not a new thing. Okay, it's only a thing that we have discovered right now. So we are not reinventing anything. We are just rediscovering things that people have already done before. And since everyone does the business their own way, it's not a one-shot solution. So if I build a pipeline for one company, it cannot be moved to another company and cannot be established there, and I cannot ask people to start using it right away. It cannot work. The tools that you create or the dashboards that you create, the reports that you build for one of the businesses cannot be moved. And the pipeline that you set might have varying number of stages in various different environments and various different business problems. Even one single company can have multiple pipelines or multiple stages looking for various different problems for the various different clients or on various different projects. Can happen, okay? So it's definitely not a one-shot solution. Everyone does DevOps their own way because it's a journey, and no one predicts how you're going to go there. Because in agile world, no one tells you how to do a particular thing. You need to get it done. You're given a task by end of the day, right? That's the goal. How to do it? You come up with an idea. That's what nurtures innovation. This is one of the things. My friend came to me just 2 months back. He told me that we have this awesome thing that we do, and we were allowed actually to pass the code to production. We are allowed to deploy, and that's the fascinating thing. I said, good for you. So how do you do it? We are allowed to fire commands on the console. Wow, that's nice. So isn't there any ops guy who would be doing that for you? He says, no. Because there are no ops guys, we are allowed to do things on our own. That's cool. What's bad? It's good, right? We don't see a pure system admin role in any of the bigger companies. People there know everything, or devs there would know everything about their ecosystem. But if you are allowing developers to push the code out, I'm not saying don't allow them. It's good to know how things move, okay? Responsibilities should be kept separate. If you overburden people with other things that they are not entitled to do or they don't do best, you're actually ruining yourself or your culture maybe, or the solution that you're building for solving a problem. Okay? Overlapping domain is a good thing. Overlapping knowledge is also a good thing. That's what DevOps brings in. It doesn't tell you that you should be overlapping responsibilities as well. We don't ask ops guys to start coding. We don't ask devs to start doing ops work, okay? There would still be teams. There would still be people who are purely doing ops works and purely doing dev work. We don't want people or one single person to do coding, testing, pushing out in production. If someone is absent, wear his hat and sit on the desk and do those stuff. No, that's not DevOps either. I'll come to the solutions, why these things are not actually called DevOps and what DevOps is actually. If this is not, then what it is? Okay, there's later one of the examples where, you know that system admin's job is actually around the clock, 24/7. They work 24 hours in shifts, and night shifts. If something breaks in the middle of the night, someone gets called, maybe using pager or pager duty, any other mechanisms. Have you ever tried calling a developer because the code was broken? And if you did, what did he answer? No one tried it. No? No one? Because that's not how the things work, right? If it doesn't work that way, then what you should be doing? People tried to do these collaborative things during the breaking hours. Things broke. Right now, it was yesterday when Glassdoor had their website down for a couple of minutes. They had it, okay? And do you think that they called the developers back then? No. No smart guy would be doing that. They must already have some of the steps written or predicted that if this is not working, my system should be automatically switching off or switching over, taking the corrective measures, fixing the things without people being around. Okay? That's what we try to do in the DevOps culture. So why do we do this? The whole idea about why is because we say, you built it, you're responsible for running it. So if you write something, be around there till the code goes to production. And is it in weeks or months, years? No, it would be in minutes. You do it. We don't allow you to switch the context. As soon as you switch your context, we know that you would be losing a lot of things. I'm writing a code, maybe 400 lines of code. There are maybe 10, 20 functions in it, doing a varied amount of things. Okay? And I presented that code to you. You told me that, okay, everything is fine except for this. I would be happy to fix it right then and there. But if I gave it to you for testing, you took your time, after a month later, you came back to me, that dude, this is not working. So do you expect me to fix it right there? No. It would take me some time, probably an hour or more, to get through and scheme through my own code what I have written back then. Context changes. A lot of time is wasted in trying to fix things, figuring out the bugs. Okay? One of the another bug fixing strategy that my friend told, I would like to add one more to it. Don't allow people to change the context on which they are working. If there's a bug, figure it out. Tell them in an actionable item that on this line, this is missing or this is not working. Fix it. The person would be more than happy to fix it right now. That was the problem back then with the waterfall model. You developed something, a complete product was done, and then you tried to test it. A couple of weeks later or months later, the testing company would tell you in a manifesto that these are the bugs that we figured out. Didn't work. That's why you moved to Agile, right? And this is the same thing that you should be doing in DevOps. Because you are implementing Agile, you should be automating that. So collaborations during thunderstorms or fortnight or during the breaking hours doesn't work. Okay, trust me, that doesn't work. Okay. So I've seen one of a couple of pitfalls again. This is when you try to transform and people try to reason with you that we have a company which is like this, it's stringent, we have a lot of hierarchies and things don't work. Probably these are three of the different cases that you would be finding. They have dev, they have ops team, and they say that we don't have people. What's the reason? We don't have people. We don't have smarter people to do DevOps. Has anybody ever heard of these things? Probably if you are a CEO or you are a CTO, you must have heard it or said it. Developers don't do that, actually. So people come up with an excuse that we have dev teams, we have ops teams, we don't have people who would be doing DevOps for us, there is no red ball there. That's what their perception is, that we would be setting up a DevOps team, trying to project everything, trying to get things around in a proper shape. That's a bad perception. Perception number two, which is bad, is to actually have a DevOps team in place. How many of the companies actually have DevOps teams here? Cool. Not a lot of them. So in smaller projects, when we deal with people, what we do is we have a team which comprises of all the people. It's a heterogeneous team. It's not just devs. So we don't go with just devs as one of the teams, and then say we want to bring in another team which is called testing team, and then we want to bring another team which is called DevOps team, for a project or for a company who's working on a product-based scale. I'm talking about one product, one project at a time. If your company is working with multiple projects, good for you. You should be having a DevOps team and then split across various different projects. It's fine. But for one product or one project, this should never be the case. Okay? The problem is, we need to make sure that horizontal communication actually works, and that should never work through one of the wire or a fuse. If that fuse blows up, you're still back in phase one, which is type A. Doesn't work. Okay? So when you have a heterogeneous team, you have a support person right in that team who is responsible for spreading the knowledge as well, which would be good. Okay? Instead of doing cross communications, it's always good to have a team which would be having all of these things together. So what's the problem with this one? We have dev, we have DevOps. Apple tried to do this. Anybody aware of the Phoenix project? No? Have you heard about it? Good. So they tried doing this before. They then rectified a lot of things, finally came up with a good plan, and they wrote a book about it. Good. So we shouldn't be doing this either. So we shouldn't be removing all the ops guys out. Like one of the pitfalls or antitypes that I talked about before was about to lead ops by dev. So let the devs do all the ops work. No, that doesn't work. Okay? Majorly because of the responsibility sharing that you shouldn't be doing. So what you should be doing? This. Now, this is again not invented by me. I've rather taken it from a website by the author is Mathev Skelton. He presented five different team structures if you want to move from non-DevOps to DevOps. Okay, this is a type one, what accounts for smooth collaboration. And this is not your actual people. Okay, that's not responsibility. It is actually a knowledge domain. So treat it as a knowledge domain that is shared between people. Okay, so blue is one of the domain, and dev, yellow, is one of the another domain. So when you take a team as together, we need to have people who understands ops. We need to have people who understands dev. In the middle part, which is a common area, we also need people who understands both the worlds together. It doesn't mean that these people would be entitled to do just dev work or just ops work. These people also have responsibility of looking at the redundant patterns and then figuring out a solution for them. How to fix it. I've seen people fix things using just rsync. Deploy stuff using rsync. Who did that? Anyone? Did you ever deploy using rsync before? Did? Good. I've seen people do stuff using simple shell scripts. And good DevOps, good, good one. I don't say that you should be doing deployment just using Capistran or use some Docker Cloud kind of stuff for deploying your systems or use ECS from Amazon. No. If things work for you, it's good. Okay? Try to minimize the time taken for all of these things. Try to reduce the redundancy in the patterns. So smooth collaboration is one of the types that you should be following. Rather, this is an ideal one. Okay? The less ideal is this. Now, these days, with the smaller companies or startups, we have smaller teams. Friends coming out of the same college, having same domain, having similar knowledge skills, they form a team like this. It's again a good one. But as the team grows, as you hire new people, it eventually falls back to type one, looking like this. Okay, again, that's not the responsibility domain, that's the knowledge domain that you should be carrying in your company. And that's another reason why big companies like Facebook or Google would not have any DevOps teams in them, because they are looking out for people who know good programming, who know system architectures, who know about operating systems well. And that pretty much relates to all the domains, right? Programming, how things work, how operating systems would work, how basic stacks would work. It is actually all your college days. So taking all the college skills and implementing here in the real life really works. But I don't think we we as in most of the people here, would literally like to remember what they learned and then try to implement it. They just see in the near future or near history, okay? What they learned in the past, near past, and what they want to implement in the near future. You just concentrate on that. The big part here is if you look back, way back in your history, what you did, you could literally learn a lot of things from it. Don't forget your 12th class books or your college days or your books that entitled networking and communication kind of things. We'll forget that, okay? That's what is important. The third kind of system or team structure is like this. Where do I implement this kind of thing? Let's say we have a client who has got its own infrastructure, and people are generally skeptical about infrastructures. Don't let you touch it. They would say, develop anything you want, develop it in the caves, we don't care, develop it anywhere, we would be paying you for that. But don't touch our infrastructure, because it's working, okay? And we would not be paying you for building another infrastructure, develop everything on ours. So this is where you develop this kind of team. You come up with a team, you have a DevOps guy in it, and that DevOps guy is responsible for supporting all your team's requirement, because you're working on a new project, which is actually striving to present something as an example to the people who are stringent, who are non-DevOps kind of people, trying to prove something to them. And this structure actually then converts into type 4 slowly and steadily, where you ditch a hole in their ops side and make them dependable on the devs eventually. That's the eventual cycle. When they take your model and try to implement it with their other projects, that's how you transition one step at a time. Okay? One of the other one that I saw, but this is not the case, okay? Where company is stringent, or your client is stringent, and you want to transform a single product, they are not allowing a new project. They want you to transform their existing company, and I was there in one of the cases like that. This really helps. You have a dev team, you have an ops team, and now I would cross my own words, you need a DevOps team in place. But that team should not exist more than 12 months. Worst case, 18 months. If it does, it would stick there forever. We don't want that, okay? So you'd be putting up a team who'd be responsible for bringing in some of the dev category people, some of the ops category people, and call it DevOps, and then split it across their existing projects. One person at a time, split it, okay? It is like throwing small steel balls around, okay? And then trying to figure out where they are and trying to bring the knowledge back. That helps. Here, the team is created only for a purpose of showing an example of how things would look like in near future. It doesn't stay there for long. If it does, they're not doing good DevOps. People are stringent. They say we are trying to change. They don't, okay? That's the big problem. So when we try to explain something to the stakeholders, the stakeholders are very important when you talk about DevOps. What importance does they carry? Money, okay? So it needs to be sponsored. Not sponsored just from the money part, but also sponsored from the cultural part. Because these were the people who actually founded the grassroots of the company. They brought some culture with them. And if they don't let off the baggage, that is going to be a problem. Okay, so when we have some talks with them, we say, okay, this is something that we would be delivering, you are in such and such state, we would be helping you to move from there to here with such and such ROI. The first question is, what ROI would I be getting? Nice cat. And what would be the timeline for it? If I'm investing X amount of dollars or money on it, would I be getting X plus one? Would I be getting X squared? And if I'd be getting this much, after how much days or how many days I would be getting it? Big question. Okay, so the problem here with ROI is we need to really struggle to help them understand that ROI is not going to come directly like you do with this bottle, maybe. I bought it for 2 rupees, I'm going to sell it for 20. ROI, 18 rupees. No, that's not what DevOps actually means. So what DevOps brings you is a different culture in which you remove the redundancy, you save the time. The example that I presented to you was the DBA guy saving 48 minutes of his day, doing some sane work instead of just looking at the monitors, right? That's where your ROI comes in. Your MTTR, mean time to recover, your round trips to fixing bugs. Let's say there is a bug on, again, a critical one. Let's say login screen failed. No one is able to log in. How critical do you think it is? Very critical, right? You need to fix it right away. If there's a cap team in place, no one is allowed to push the code on production, how much time do you think it would take? Ringing people, calling the developer. Developer would not start working unless and until he gets approval from it. Once you get approval, there would be a time window decided, and then you push the code. How much time do you think it would take? And if it takes, let's say X amount of time, then you are losing a lot of traffic, right? Another problem here, that people do not take responsibility, okay? They don't take responsibility, and that's the biggest problem that we are trying to solve by implementing DevOps in an agile culture. What they do when we implement agile and DevOps in an organization, start doing this, okay? So those are the employees, and we are poor cats who are actually standing there, listening to them, trying to understand what the problem actually is, okay? So the problem here is they don't try to get responsible for what they did, okay? And this is not even a problem. There is another smaller problem, which is at the nip of the bud. And the problem is they don't get appreciated for it. The hierarchy, the long hierarchy that I was talking of, let's say I created a code, I created a nice feature, a shiny one, and I committed it, pushed it, tested it, everything went fine, and when it was time for getting appreciation, my team lead got it. So team lead said, wow, thanks, I did it. How good is that? It's good, it's bad, it's worst. None of the employees would like it, and that generally happens in a longer hierarchy. Or even if it is appreciated and properly delivered, it doesn't get delivered to the bottom level. It doesn't get percolated through, okay? And that's what starts all the culture about not taking responsibility. Because it's like, who cares, okay? And we have to stop it. We stop it by creating some feedback loops. Anybody heard about feedback loops? People who would be working on DevOps, CI part would be knowing what I'm talking about. The feedback loops, anyone? Anyone else? Cool. So the feedback loops, we need to create faster feedback loops which are shorter, yet amplified. So what do I mean? Shorter in terms of sense of time, and amplified in sense of actionable items, what you need to do, okay? If something failed, there's a bug, something failed, it broke, build broke, we don't know why. The mail gets triggered. It slacks you, or the CI system sends you an email, or texts you, whatever the mode of communication is, it doesn't tell you what happened. It would simply tell you it broke. Build number 49 broke for some reason, I don't know what. So this is not an amplified loop. When you want to make amplified, you say that, dude, line number 45, this is wrong, it broke because of this particular dependency, it's not there. That's what I mean by actionable item and an amplified loop, okay? And when you communicate it, not to the team, but to a particular person who did that, he would be happy to fix it, correct? In front of so many people, if I tell my colleague that he's doing a wrong thing, he would never do a right one. If I take him aside and then tell him that this is something that you did wrong, he would be presenting it in a very nice manner when he does it next time, right? That's what the human psychology is. So I did my master's. But I think I shouldn't have been doing that. I should have been doing psychology, because it is more about a psychological impact on how you develop a product and how you deliver it. How do you treat your customers and your employees inside by helping them use better technology and build better solutions? That's what DevOps is for me. So when you stay composed, because you know what you are doing is right, and tell them that we would be letting you go off all the baggage that you have, the only thing that you need to do is walk with us, one step at a time, one problem at a time, one single tool at a time. Let's introduce it. Let's not build a complete CI/CD pipeline and then bump it across the devs and the the testers to figure out that it works or not. I've seen people do this. I've seen people move from one cloud solution to another one. I've seen people change their virtual machine architecture to container architecture, right? Like that. Didn't work. Failed miserably. Okay? We wouldn't want to do that. That's what all the talk is all about. What you shouldn't be doing. Okay? And when it comes to setting up the culture, like I told you, it cannot be done within a night. So what do? Do you preach people? I've seen some of the nice spiritual talks going on in the Tata Industries. What they do is they held these talks daily, 9 o'clock, maybe for 30 minutes, ask people to do meditation, some nice words to them so that they keep them motivated, more productive to work. IT doesn't work, okay? What do we do? So here we support culture with tools. And that's how we introduce DevOps one thing at a time, okay? If you already have a culture in place and you still want to set up CI/CD pipeline, many of you might be curious about what to do in that kind of scenario, never move from dev to ops. Never do that. The only good thing that you should be doing is automate ops first and slowly move towards devs, because devs are already doing their work. They're doing it great. They're committing thousands of lines of code. What is not changing is ops. So when you try to build a CI/CD pipeline first, make sure that you stick to a pattern, develop ops first, and then try to move it towards the dev's end. That would be really a smooth transition to do. So here, when you try to support culture with tools, a couple of things that we would be trying to support, like forcing code reviews. Has anybody tried to do that in their company? Forcing it. I want to install code review, and you should be using it from day second. There's a nice DevOps guy that we hired, and he's suggesting something that this is a shiny tool that we should be using for better productivity. Is it going to increase the productivity or it's going to decrease the productivity? What my immediate thought is, it is going to decrease the productivity at least by 50% for a couple of weeks. People trying to do this. Okay? Or committing message standards. People frequently forget about this. If they want to attach their commits to maybe Jira, or some CI engine. There are some messaging standards that you need to follow, okay? Do you preach people, do you train people? Probably there would be a talk like this in the company where all the employees are sitting and they present their new DevOps guy and the DevOps guy would tell that these are the changes that you need to live with from now onwards. Doesn't work that way. Unit tests or notifying the action items. Doesn't work. So what do we do? So if you want to make it work, like the wrapper that I told you about, the mercurial wrapper, okay? You could use that wrapper here. Instead of forcing people, instead of blaming them or keeping them like this in one room and then preaching them for an hour and then expecting that they would do it, create a small tool, one aim at a time. Well, let's take an example for commit messages. If I'm committing a code, simply write a hook on my Git or Subversion or Mercurial, whatever you are using. Or even on the dev side as pre-commit hooks. If you add it there with a simple notification that this is not a standard message, it should be something like this, how much time do you think that person would take to recommit it? Because he knows that he needs to commit it right away. He tries to commit it. Next second, there is a message. Okay? Looks at the message. How much time would it take for him to read it? Another second. Change the message. Not more than 30 seconds, he would be fixing it. And if he is a regular committer, he would remember it next time. Simple idea, simple thing. No preaching required, okay? No emails required. You're not notifying anyone. You're just creating a small feedback loop which is effective, which tells what has to be done. Simply, you could do the same thing for your code reviews. You could do the same thing for your unit tests. We implemented that at one of the clients where the unit test cases would not take more than 45 seconds to run. But when executed on a bigger thing or a bigger product, okay, there was a problem with it. So you could do that. And most of all, create bots for everything, but one thing at a time. Block nobody, that should be the attitude. Okay? We tried doing this at our home. So block nobody. And what's the smallest thing that we could do? keep all the things in their proper places, so nobody gets blocked. Would you expect it all to be on the, in the bedroom on some of the chairs? No, it should be properly in the rack, okay? So you'd block nobody. For the developers not to be getting blocked by the devs, there should be self-service portals. Change your password. Look out for code where it is. Know your branches. Know your commit messages. Know your tickets. Everything in proper places. Okay? And try to repeat yourself faster by reducing the redundancy. That's what it is. And for the business benefits, sponsors, when you try to please your stakeholders, okay, and bring the things along with them, these are the things that actually are for the betterment. DevOps brings this, and everybody is aware of it. So I would not be going through the slides for the for a lot of time, like better ROI, faster to market, high trust environment, greater job satisfaction because of the appreciation that you get. Remember that underlining quote is, you built it, you run it. Okay? Better mean time to recover, quantifiable statistics, and better predictability. Now this is, again, required, that's quantifiable statistics, it is required for better predictability. If there is a DevOps guy and he doesn't know what the system statistics are, cannot improve it. If I want to run faster, I need a baseline. How do I tell you that I ran faster than previous day? I need to be sure about what my speed was. Statistics, right? Needs to be there. So all these things you already are aware of. So what DevOps is actually not? Not about tools. Not about just culture. Not about devs and ops. Not about the teams. Okay? Not about the fancy job title. It's not about one team. It's not about automation. Okay? And definitely it's not everything. If you want to automate the complete agile, you're doing DevOps. No, it's not. So what it actually is, let's consolidate everything that we have heard so far on slides. It's what works for you. If it works for you, if it makes things faster for you, if it makes your life easy, if you, it changes the environment in which you are working, if it makes your employees happy, that's DevOps. Okay? You're trying to implement Agile, so it's a complementary part of being Agile. Trying to implement Agile in a very good way. Collaboration and communication between the teams. Horizontal communication, it's hard to establish. Easiest way, reduce the hierarchy. It would make things easier for you. Caring for the problem statement that people are bringing in and the business is trying to solve. It's an experience that you deliver. Faster things, better feedback loops, no one blaming someone, everyone appreciating things, allowing people to innovate, run the things in their production all by themselves. That person would start to take responsibility for it automatically. You don't need to force it on them, right? So it's a culture that you live with. And it tries to make sense when you try to mold people with it, not about a software, right? So thank you so much for being patient and listening to me for this last 1 hour. Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you.